हाय, आई एम अभिषेक शर्मा. आई वर्क विथ ऑब्जेक्ट ऑटोमेशन एज ए रिसर्च स्कॉलर. सो आई एम शेयरिंग माई स्क्रीन. फर्स्ट आई वॉन्ट टू कन्फर्म दैट इट्स माई वॉइस क्लियर.
Yeah, your voice is
हेलो.
clear. Please share your screen.
ओके श्योर. Is my screen visible?
Yeah.
So today in this presentation, I want to talk about the data augmentation. So in the previous session, people might have noticed that Vaibhav introduced the term of this data augmentation. So here in this session, I'll talk about what it is and a very like robust and new framework of this, which is AugMax. The agenda of my presentation is that what is deep learning, and like when we do deep learning, we need a lot of data. So what can we do that when we don't have enough data or we have insufficient data or limited data? So there are certain approaches that we can do. It can be done with image type of data or other types of data like audio signal or some speeches and something. But the focus will be on images data. So what are the approaches that we do when we have limited data? And then what is data augmentation and the different techniques of data augmentation? So data augmentation is basically generating new type of data with the limited data you have. And there are certain techniques of it. And there are some new and latest and advanced frameworks which are available. And these are the research paper from 2018, 19, 20, and as late as 2021. So AugMax is the focus of my presentation, which is one of the framework of data augmentation, which came in 2021. So what is deep learning? Basically, like it's like neural network, and through a lot of data, it's a subset of AI and machine learning. So we train our data like we train ourselves, like we train our mind. So we put information, and that information get trained in the form of neurons connected. So that is the basic fund of deep learning. So in neural networks, there are structures, layered structures, and they are stacked together, like one layer after the another. And a data flows from one side, and from the other side, we get some output. Output like we classify something, we infer something, we make out of something. So, like all other algorithms, we give data and we get some output. Here also, in deep learning or deep neural networks, we provided data and we get some output out of it. But the difference here is the way it works. It works like learning from one layer to other layer, and segregating the input in different parts and doing the thing. So it's a complete study, complete science, which is in focus. So if we join deep learning and data, so data is very important for the deep learning. So all the deep learning models, they require large amount of data for training. Without data, we cannot train our model. Something like image classification or video recognition. So we have seen like a lot of like you might have seen a lot of videos or blogs which works classifying the images or classifying the videos, or deep fake videos you might have seen in the news, like somebody faking someone else's video. So these models are trained with a large database, like large amount of data. And but sometimes we don't have enough data for the training, and sometimes we don't get enough data, or sometimes we don't have enough data for certain scenarios. Something like we want to train a model, identify a specific type of bird. So it is not possible to have that much of data for that specific type of bird. So such type of problem arises that we can make a model, but we don't have enough data. So in those scenarios with limited data, with insufficient data, there are a lot of problems in developing the model. Model either give us low accuracy, it will underperform, it will not give correct prediction, it will do overfitting. Overfitting is like training your model with same type of data, with too much of same type of data. So what happens then is that when you train a model with the same type of data, it will predict that thing accurately, but it will not predict other thing correctly. So if you are making a model training a cat and you train it with a specific type of cat, so and with lot of images of that cat, so what will happen is that it will predict that cat correctly and it will be robust for that cat, but for other type of cat it will fail. So this is called as overfitting, when your model predicts something very accurately but not all the things. So that is overfitting. Underfitting is that it's not fitting the model or it's not even correctly predicting what we want to do. So data is very important in deep learning. We need data to train our models. If we talk of deep learning and the data and limited training data, so the data and the model and the problem, everything is proportional. They are linearly related, in the sense that suppose what I'm talking right now in my speech, in my voice, there is lot of information you can make out. There is some context, there is some grammar, there is some pitch. I can make out lot of things. So I need a big, large model, maybe with multiple layers, to identify all the patterns in my voice. So model and data both are proportional. And to solve complex problem, we want bigger data and bigger model. So to identify what I'm speaking, what my grammar is, what my pitch is, what my the phonetics is, so we need a bigger model to identify all these things. So we, in the bigger model, in the sense, multiple layers doing identifying the complex things. So each layer in the model, it finds some patterns from the input. So in what I'm speaking, you might get a layer will identify what is the grammar. A layer will identify what is the tone of my, is it I'm talking like an angry person, or I'm nervous, or I'm excited, or I'm joyous. So for a model to understand lot of things, a data should be large, and model will also be complex. And in a model, the last layers comes, they are generally made to make the final decision, or find out what is the final output is. So when a problem is very complex, so complex problem in a machine learning or deep learning is majority of the time is like recognition of something. It is not easy to identify voices, images. Like we need a good amount of data and a good amount of a bigger model to train this. So to do image classification, we need a lot of data to do a classification. To identify a cat, we need a model which can identify, like which is trained on multiple thousands of images of cat, then it can identify the cat. And if you want the specific of the cat, like which breed it is, what is the specific genetics it belong, is it white, black? So we need more data, more complex model. So like if I talk of deep learning and training it with limited training data, so there are problems with it. So we all have seen about this autonomous driving vehicle or self-driving cars in the news. The Tesla is self-driving car, Tata, and Tata is building a self-driving car. So what they are trying to do with the self-driving car is they are building a model, machine learning model, and they are trying to identify real time what is there in the path, in the road, identify the barrier, identify the pole, identify the car. So what happens is that when you develop such model in your place, you train with it with something, but training requires a lot of data. And sometimes we really don't know what is the real-time corruption is. Real-time corruption is that we are developing a model, we are training with a lot of poles, but a pole can be like millions of images of pole can in real world can happen. Like it can be blurred, it can be with some noise, or it may be possible sensor is giving some noise. So there is a pole, image of the pole in the front of, but sensor, the sensor is, the image sensor is not giving the correct signal. Image sensor is not working fine. So these are the unforeseen corruptions that a real model fails. So generally in a self-driving car or like any model, when training happens, it happens with limited data. But in the real world, it faces new scenarios, new challenging scenarios, a different type of noises, different type of images. So a model is trained to identify cars in the road, but can you is it possible to have all the dimensions of the car, in the sense that it can be skewed, it can be tilted, it can be uplifted, it can be zoomed, it can have some rain noise, like any type of noise. So and such scenarios our model does not predict very accurately, and when it tries to run, it fails sometime. So in such scenarios, there is always mismatch between the training and the test distribution. Even though our model may be performing excellent, almost 100% accuracy while testing at the scenarios where we have developed it, but in the real-time world, it might fail because it might see other complicated scenarios under complicated corruptions. So here the point I want to make is that to train a model, we want data. And data, although we generate a lot of data, the data is not sufficient always. So how do we get more data? Like the question is, how can we get more data? How can we produce more data? And if not, we can produce more data, what else we can do? So one thing that we can do is that we can do transfer learning. Transfer learning is like what we humans do all the time. So suppose like we humans are trained to identify animals. So we know how does an animal look like. Like we have seen a lot of animals. So we know what animals look like. A new animal comes in the front of us, we'll identify it. It's not like we have to train ourselves from the scratch. We know already how animals look like. A new animal comes in the front of us, we can identify it. Similarly, in transfer learning, what we do is we already use a pre-trained model to extend it. So we want to build a model to train to identify a cat, but we don't have enough images of the cat. So what we can do is we can use a model which identifies the animal, and we can extend to identify the cat. See, this model already identify the animal. We have to already extend it to identify the cat. Second thing what we can do is, while developing the model or training the model, we can extend our database. Like we can extend our data set. To do that, what we can do is we can changes in the images, in the sense that minor changes, minor flips, minor translation. So that what will happen when we are training, our neural network, our model will think that it's a different image. Although it's an original image, but it will think it is a different image because we have changed it slightly. So we can enlarge our data set. This is second way. And this is basically data augmentation is. So here you can see there is one butterfly, and the image shows that you have detextured it, you have decolorized it, you have edge enhanced, you have flipped, rotated, and everything. So basically there is one image and you have transformed into multiple image. This is the basic principle of data augmentation, like generating more data from the existing data. And in this presentation, I'm talking about the data augmentation, or I'll talk about the other frameworks in the end, I'm considering the image data, but this data augmentation technique is applied everywhere, not only in the image data, but other type of data also, like generating new data with the existing data is the data augmentation. So what, in simpler term, you enlarge your data set. Suppose there is one cat, and what we have done is we have generated 5 more images of the cat. So one is tilted, one is zoomed, one is flipped, And when we'll train our model with this cat, with these images, it will think five type of cats, or like images of five cats, and our model training will be better. But there is one problem here, like training the model with such scenarios, like training with same type of cat, it will do overfitting. Overfitting again, it's like it will identify this cat perfectly, but may not identify other types of cat perfect, other types of cat. So this is the problem. This is the problem that we have to understand while building the framework. So basically, data augmentation is that technique. From that, we generate new data. We increase the amount of data by adding some slight modification with the existing data. It may be if it is image data, so we can zoom it, we can tilt it, skew it, flip it, we can add noise, we can blur it. So this is the data augmentation. If you talk of the framework, like the augmax, which I'll give a demo and I'll talk about, what it does, it generates new images while training, and it train our deep neural network. And with this, what happens is that it increase the robustness of the model. Increasing robustness means it perform better, it will give accurate result while testing. And when we do data augmentation, like it's an important component of our deep neural networks. Like it can lower the overfitting and it can increase our testing accuracy. So what are the data augmentation techniques? This again, I'm referring to the image data augmentation. So there are two types of techniques we can do. One is position augmentation, or second is color augmentation. I think this is the image of bird. I'm not good with animals, so I'm not sure, but this is a bird. Like if it is clear, then you can see this. There is one image which is blurred, one it is slightly rotated, one this is zoomed, one it is flipped, one it is color changed, and one this is added noise. So in the position, we scale, we crop, we flip, we add padding, we even rotate, we skew it, we tilt it, and cut out also we do, like we make cut a leg of this bird. So again, if you cut the leg of the bird and train the model, it is still that bird only. The model should have been able to identify this as a bird. So this is cut position augmentation. Second is color augmentation. So in color augmentation, we change the color profile. So color profile, like we can increase the brightness, decrease the brightness, change contrast, change saturation, change hue. All those things what we do while working with images, so that we can do. So these are the techniques that we use in data augmentation. But this is just a technique. What is the basic framework that I'll talk about later? So one way is adding noise. So there are two severity level here. One is the original image. Second is noise, added noise, but a little noise. Third one is a more noise added. So our model will be trained better identifying this. Second is this zoom. So there is an image of the cat. It is zoomed from different angles. Third is this flip. So our dog is flipped. So flipping is basically like our model should able to identify a flip dog. So that is the idea. This is the rotation. And this is a color augmentation. So color augmentation is, as I explained before, you change the brightness, you change the contrast, you change the saturation, you change the hue. So you are changing the base color profile. You can do other things also. So you can blur it, which I have not put, but you can blur it, you can add noises, you can changes color profile, like only green, only blue, only red component as we do in Photoshop and all. But still, it should be still a tiger only. And if we make a cutout or cutout of the leg or something, so model should able to identify. So these are the techniques that we use to do in data augmentation. Data augmentation is basically generating more data to train our model so that our model perform better. It should give better result. I'll make a pause here and I'll ask if any questions till now, because in the next section I'll talk about the data augmentation frameworks, and then I'll give a demo what I've done with this AugMax framework. So any questions till now? I'll wait for a minute and then I'll continue. Okay, I'm continuing from here. So before that, I have talked about what is data augmentation and data augmentation techniques. Now I'll talk about the frameworks, and these frameworks, which is auto augment, rand augment, augmix, and augmax. These are like very new. These are from after 2018. So auto augment came in 2018 from Google. Then rand augment, then augmix was in 2020, and augmax is from this year only, like 2021. So these are the very latest framework of data augmentation. Machine learning and deep learning is relatively new, but still going from last decade or so. But in the machine learning, what we were following is developing model and training it with data. But generating more data is relatively new. It's much newer as compared to a complete science of data deep learning. So the main focus is the AugMax, which I've like tried, tested, and researched on. But I'll talk few lines on auto augment, rand augment, augmix, and augmax. It's because these models are advancement over other models. So auto augment, it came in 2018. It's written here that it's using reinforcement learning search algorithm to search through a possible set of data augmentations on image data sets. Basically, there are infinite type of techniques that you can use to generate images. But what is the best possible techniques that will train our model in the best way? And this auto augment was trying to do that only. So it was doing a reinforcement learning search algorithm. And reinforcement is like punishing your algorithm when it is not giving you correct result, and giving it advantage or training it like giving it advantage when it is giving you the desired result. So this is the reinforcement learning. So basically, from all the augmentations you can do, it is trying to find out what is the best to train the model. And basically every framework will do that only. So it is the initial that framework. So these are the technicalities. I think that is not needed right now. So there was 16 data augmentation operations and number of possibilities written, but I think this is not important. Second is rand augment. It came in 2019. So it was advancement over auto augment and other previous augmentation frameworks. So rand augment was much better in comparison to auto augment and other frameworks like population based search. It significantly reduces the overhead of the automated data augmentation. So I've taken this screenshot from the research paper, and they have given the comparison and performance matrix, and they have proved that it is much better in comparison to the previous methods. Now this third is AugMix, and this is the model that I'll focus. The reason being, from this model, the AugMax is based on. on this model Augmax is based on. So Augmax is like generating new images and then training the data. But there are some unique things in this Augmax. So there are three pipelines. Like it could be any, but while testing, it was three. Three in the sense that from one image, they are generating three images. So if it is possible to see what is written here, it is translate X. So it is bit rotated in the X direction. Like translated means shifted, sorry. This is rotation, this is posturize. And then this is equal, then shear. So basically they have generated three images. And these three images are added pixel by pixel following a weightage. So now this is the new images generated using this original image. And this original image, this original image, and the augmented image, these two images are merged to find a final image. And the merging takes place following some weightage. So it depends on the certain scenarios, what could be the accurate weight to find a good image that could train a model. This was Augmix based on. So in 2020, it came out and it was much robust in comparison to the other models. Or the previous models. Now our model Augmax, so which I have tested. So in basically in data augmentation in this research paper, they have explained it like while generating new data, data augmentation framework or tool, it focus on either diversity or hardness. So suppose you are generating new images from the original image. You are generating new image from the original image. It could be diverse, it could be hard. The difference is here is that diverse images are spread out in the cell. It consider like all kind of scenarios, like majority of scenarios. Hard is like corner images. So suppose there is a model which you want to train on aeroplane recognition. So suppose there are so much diverse images of aeroplane. So that is called diversity, like uniqueness of images. Hardness is like corner images, which means like image which we can barely understand. So these are the type of those images. Like hard is like corner images which are not easy, which we cannot easily understand. So to train a model identifying an aeroplane, if the image is so vague that it's not easy to understand, but still an aeroplane image and it should get identified as an aeroplane image, that's a hard cases. So there are in this research paper, they have talked about frameworks like standard Augmix, which it is based on, and then PGD attack. So they are saying that the standard is of no use. The Augmix, it's a very good framework to generate augmented images, but the images are diverse. They are not hard enough. So they are not, this Augmix framework, which I've talked about, it was not making hard images. And there was also one framework which they have talked about, which is PGD attack. So this framework only produces hard images, not the diverse images. Their framework, which is Augmax, it produces both type of images, diverse and hard. So when we train our model with a both type of image, it will be most robust. It will be most robust. It will give least amount of error.
People can use it. இதெல்லாம் தெரியுமா டேட்டாவை ஆகமெண்ட் பண்றது. அது வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் சப்ஜெக்ட் ஆக்சுவலி டுடேஸ் வேர்ல்ட். இது ஒரு 80 GB-க்கு நாங்க டேட்டாவை ஆகமெண்ட் பண்ணி வச்சிருப்போம்.
ஹலோ கணேஷ் சார்,
அது கண்டிப்பா உங்களுக்கு வந்து 100 டிவி வேணும். இதெல்லாம் இதுவே 80 GB னா 100 பீப்பிள் 80 GB யூஸ் பண்ண என்ன ஆகும்?
ஹலோ கணேஷ் சார்,
சரி ஓகே.
So I was talking about this Augmax, and like it's the most latest advanced research framework. Just came in 2019, and it produces most diverse and hard image to train a model. And when we tested it, it was almost like giving the mean corruption error was negligible. Like the error is very negligible. I'll talk about this framework in detail. So this AugMax framework, it is built on the top of AugMix, and what it does basically, it does the same thing. Like it tries to generate three images, merge these three images, but there is a difference here. The difference here is that the way it tries to merge images. So in the AugMax, the final image is kind of random. AugMix, sorry. But in AugMax, the final image is based on some kind of prediction. Prediction is like whether this image will train our model in the best possible way or not. So for an example, like I have your photo, like I have your photo, and I'm making some modification. So I am generating some augmented images of your photo. So if I change it so much that you will not able to identify, or anyone will not able to identify that, is it your photo? It is your photo. So it is a waste. So that's what AugMax is doing. AugMax is discarding all those images, all those augmented images which are not useful to train the model. So if I make an augmented image of a butterfly and no one can identify that it is a butterfly, so it's a waste to train our model with that augmented image. But that works. That what AugMax is doing. It is kind of doing this. It is doing some kind of prediction with the final image. So basically, there is some change the way it generates images, and it is built upon this AugMix only. Okay, I'll give a demo. I think there is not sufficient time left. If there is time, I'll talk about this algorithm in detail. Basically, in the simplest explanation, there is one image, and there are three images generated from these images. These are combined, and then these three images which are combined, it is also combined with the main image, and this last image will be used to train our model. So this is the AugMax data augmentation framework. While training and testing this framework, I use this CIFAR-10C and CIFAR-100 data, and the architecture and the layer was ResNext 18 and ResNext 29. So what CIFAR-10 data is, these are basically image data. So it's a colored image data from in 32 by 32 pixel in three dimension, like a color image, and 5,000 training images, 10,000 testing images. So with this data, I have trained my model. So model got trained with the original image, also the data augmented image, like what it generated while training. And then in the end, I tested it that CIFAR-10C data set. So CIFAR-10C data set is simply the CIFAR-10 data set with some noise added, like with some corruption added, with some modifications. So I'll show it what CIFAR-10 and what CIFAR-100 is, CIFAR-10C is. So this is our CIFAR-10 data set. Basically, these are some images of airplane, bird, cat, deer, dog. And this is CIFAR-10. CIFAR-100 is a bigger data set. But CIFAR-10C is the same data set with some noise added. Okay, so that would be more complicated. So this was the idea. We train it with CIFAR-10 and test it with CIFAR-10C. Now I'll explain how we can test this framework. This is the GitHub repository that I cloned in the system, and here they have given everything. This is the file that I needed to train the model. This is the file that I need to test the model, and in the end, we'll get the result. That is one paper which explains everything. This is the paper. And also the mean corruption error and the error and the robustness this model is having.
Hello, I'm not able. I'm connected with a university server. I hope I'm audible. Okay, so I'm connected with the server. Okay, I was installed in the node one. So here I have like cloned the repository in this AM test folder. I think this is visible. Okay, AM test. Augmax. This is the Augmax folder which I've git cloned, and here you can see every file is there. There is this data loader folder which will load all the data, CIFAR 10 data. It's a big data set, around a GB or something, and in this data set folder it will get loaded. This augmax training.dpp.py, this is that file that I used for training, and test.py is the file that I used for testing. Since model training, I'll show it, but it takes a lot of time, so I've already trained the model and put it in the pre-trained model, and I'll show the testing result. But before that, I'll show how we can train this. Okay, activate the Conda environment. Okay. So I have started the training here. So it's saying file already downloaded and verified, and it'll start training, and it'll start. The training will happen 200 epoch. Here there are certain parameters that I had to give. One is the SRP. So SRP is the source root path. So where will be the output will be stored? Where the output will be stored in this folder? So the path. That I have to give, and DRP is where the data will reside. So now it has started, like it has started the training, and it is giving SA, RA, accuracy, and this loss while each during the training of each epoch. So this has the training has taken the data from the output, and this training will go for I don't know, but maybe a day or 15 hours or 20 hours. It's almost impossible to train this in your system. And this training is happening because there is NVIDIA CUDA GPU is there. Without that, it is almost impossible to train it. So before training, I have to install all the prerequisites. So I have installed PyTorch, which was needed, and a WAN library, which was needed. these were the and other basic tools related to machine learning like Panda, NumPy, and all these are the basic libraries and the packages that I have installed. So the training has started, and it will save the output in this save root path, which is the output folder. I'm going to stop it because like, it's not useful to train it. I'll test already trained model and I'll show the result. But before that, if I could show about the training. Okay, so this was the training that I did up to 200 epoch, and it took around 20 hours for me to train this, and it generated a file like this, which is in this folder, a file with the name was best underscore dot pth. I'll check. Okay. File numbers. Okay, so in the PTN model, the data was ciphered 10, and it was the training based on ResNext 18 architecture. It should come, yeah. So the best underscore sa.pth. So this was the file. It got generated after the complete training. It took around a day almost. So this is the R model file. Now I have to test it. For that, I have to use test.py. And it will use the Cypher 10C data. So Cypher 10 is used for training, Cypher 10C is for testing. And I had to manually download the Cypher 10C in this framework. They have not given it directly. So for training part, we don't need to download any data. It will get downloaded automatically. For testing part, we have to manually download it and do it. So, where is test.py? Yeah, this is test.py. So from this, I'll do the testing of that model, pre-trained model. Here, I'm running the Python test.py. Very simple. Then the data set is Cypher 10. Data root part is data sets. It will take data from the data set. Then MD model architecture is ResNext 18. Do you bin? It could be ResNext. Whatever the model is, I'll put this. So the train model is on ResNext, ResNet 18. So it is ResNet 18 here. If it is ResNext, then it is ResNext here. Then the CKT path parameter here, I have given the complete part of the folder where the model lies. So slash this, it is best underscore sa.pth. So slash under this is best. So this is the model. Now, this testing will test the trained pre-trained model or that model. It has now started. It will not take much time. It will take very less time. The training always take a lot of time. Testing is much easier. So model training is making complicated layers, complicated neural networks and all. But while testing, we have already modeled. So actually, in day-to-day life, we interact with the models every time, even with the Google search, even with the YouTube search or anything. Even while shopping in Amazon, we test their model, we run their model. So testing is that only, like running that model or executing that model. So what it is doing here is that it's giving loader for XYZ noise, this noise ready. Basically, it has loaded all that testing data, CIFAR 10C data, which is based on noise, and it will test on the model. So it is giving the accuracy. It took 5.83 second, and this is the corruption value. So I'll explain what it is, like 0.83 for this impulse noise, 0.943 for defocus blur, 0.843 for this class blur. So it's basically testing the model based on the images, corrupted images. In the end, this framework will generate an output file. It will take a minute or two more. Yeah, so testing got completed. It threw me a value which is mean corruption, which is 0.9036. I'll explain this file in my PPT, but remember this value, 0.9, this around one. And it generated a text file in the same folder where the model was there. So model was there in the Pre-trained model, Cypher 10, ResNet 18, Augmix, DuoBin. Okay. If I do ls ra, so yeah. So whatever testing we did, it generated this file. Although I have already tested it, it was there. If I'll remove it, it will get regenerated. So actually, basically, it has replaced it. The time is.
Can you please speak a little bit louder?
Is my voice is not clear? Okay.
It's a bit feeble.
Okay. Am I clear now?
Perfect.
Okay, thank you. So while after the testing, the model, the testing generated a test result.txt. It's a file where the result is there. If I test it, if I check it, so this is the output, which was there by testing, this same output. In the end, there is mean corruption accuracy, which is 0.9036. And yeah, this is the result. If I have to explain this, like what was the training and the testing, I'll re-explain from the paper or the PPT. So in the Augmix folder, Augmix framework, we used So this ResNet, it was ResNet 2018, but not ResNet 29. But we can change it. Like we can do many types of training. So it was trained on CIFAR 10 dataset, and it was trained in this particular server, which I've demoed from the university. It took a lot of time, and in the end, it showed around this time 0.9036. Basically, this is mean corruption error, and it showed the robustness. Robustness means how the model will behave against the image noise. So if there is an image, so this was the training part, but when will you test the model with same image with some noises or something like this? So these are the images of airplane, automobile, bird. So it should identify it correctly. So when we have introduced it some noise, so model training was so robust, or this framework was so robust, that the mean corruption error was almost one. So the lower the mean corruption error, the higher the value as per this model explanation. The other thing I want to talk about, that we can change the way we want to train the model. So it is better to show this from GitHub. Okay. So in this framework, the first parameter is GPU. So GPU is like, if your system is having multiple GPUs, so which GPU you want to train it with? Zero is for first GPU. Second is the source root path. So where you want to save root, save the output basically. And this is the DRP, the data root path, where from where the data, the framework will fetch the data. And finally, the data set on which you want to train. And then this is the backbone. So like what I did was I trained it on ResNet architecture on CIFAR-10 data. You can change it. You can use other type of architecture, other type of data. If you run this command, it will tell what all arguments and could do, and it will start training. And then in the end, you can test using this testing test.py. So it's the same thing. You have to provide it. Where is the data set? Where is the data root path? What is the type of model, means like on what architecture it is based on? And then the CKPT path. CKPT path is where was the model. So in this command, this was the CKPT path. So this was the folder in which the model was there, best underscore sa.pth, and it got trained. Yeah. So any questions till now, or do I need to if I can explain the paper if needed, but it is, I think it's sufficient for the day. Any questions till now? From this data augmentation frameworks, or the training and testing part, or related to data augmentation, or how I trained and tested it. Any questions, any queries, participants?
Yeah, if there are, people will post it or send an email, Abhishek, please go ahead.
Okay. So this is from my side. I have explained the complete training and testing. I have not explained the algorithm. Okay. So in the algorithm, it works in two stages. So basically, it generates new images from the clean sample by applying several augmentation operators. So it generates new images by applying several augmentation operations. This is the first stage. Second is, these augmented images from these three chains, they are combined together with the original and the clean sample. So these three images are combined, and it was also then combined with the original image. So in the end, in the final image, if it is clear, or you can see that this is a bit blurred and noisy, and this image is a bit like this. So this final image, it is having some source of randomness. So it depends on the weightage that we use to join three images, or the weight we use to this framework will use to join with the original image, and the severity of operation. So the auto contracts, the shear, the rotate, the translate x, the translate y, how much we are doing this. So if you are doing very little translate x, the final augmented image will not have that much of randomness. So there is randomness, and it depends on all the operations that we do here. And it also depend, it is also depend on the length of augmented chains and mixing weights. So length means like how much operation you need each chain, and the weights we are choosing. The adversarial controller in the augmax, it's using friendly adversarial training. So basically they want to say that final image, it is not too much random, like it's not that extreme that it's a waste for the model to train, but it is making some kind of prediction to train the model, like is it worthy to train it or not, like is it not that bad that it is waste, like if we do so much translation, so much auto contrast, so much rotate or something, the final augmented image will be so different from the original image that it was also impossible for humans to identify it. So the final image should be like, it should cover all the possible scenarios, and it should include all type of noises so that the model will be the best. So the basic theme is that model training should be the best. And this was the basic algorithm. It also used a different type of normalization layer, which they have shared is dual batch instance normalization. It's like they are doing normalization in two parts or two steps, two splits, to address the issue of heterogeneity. So heterogeneity means that it should be more diverse, not like homogeneous, or all the augmented images are of the same type. So there is thing called dual batch normalization looping. This is the term which they have proposed in the paper. And normalization is that when we do some changes with the data, it goes beyond the boundary of what is recognizable. So for an example, if I have to explain, this is layman language. So there is visible light we see, and we are doing some changes in this visible light. And if this visible light is with some changes, the data of visible light goes from visible range to infrared or infrared range or other side of the spectrum. So it is not useful to use that data. So we do normalization. It is there in machine learning or deep learning. So they have used some unique type of dual batch normalization here. And finally, this two things like dual batch instance normalization and their controller of this augmax of image merging of pixel one by one, where they are trying to do some prediction. So there is complete algorithm which is written in a paper. This is the mix. So they have explained that algorithm completely step by step in the code, but I think it's not current scope of the presentation. So I've understood it briefly. Yeah. So this is from my side. Any questions, Stella?
Someone wanted to know the title of that research paper.
Okay, Augmax adversarial composition of robust augmentation for robust training.
Yeah, actually, you know, end of the presentation and end of the workshop, we will be sharing all the documentation regarding the all, you know, presentations, whatever we have been covering. So right now, I just typed, you know, the Augmax on the chat window, but you all will get the, you know, the PPT and all very well, and even the video. we have been recording these sessions, and you know, we'll be sharing that. Any questions for Abhishek regarding AugMax data augmentation, the special tool these days, because of, you know, the data is very important. Algorithm one can write, but yeah, whatever data, based on the data only, like, you know, your accuracy will be well defined. So any questions? Okay. I think Vinay, you want to say a note about Abhishek, and then I will do a conclusion.
Audience, any doubt from your side? Yeah. There's no doubt from our side, sir, so you can give the vote of thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Abhishek, for the wonderful session. Really, you know, these kind of technical, you know, deep technical things are all very important for our, you know, all these workshops, and also for the students and faculties, you know, who want to really develop, you know, new skills and new algorithms and all. And, you know, thank you very much.
Thanks, participants. Thanks, everyone. Yeah. Thanks for providing this opportunity. Thanks,
yeah. So. And, you know, as part of the, you know, the second day, you know, whatever we covered, you know, you guys, you all know that we started the first session with Dr. Panda from Ohio State University, where he talked about the challenges and the opportunities in designing middleware for HPC and AI. The middleware is nothing but, you know, we are talking about the middleware software here. And he explained about the MEA pitch. Two, that's a highly performing, you know, the library for MPI, and you know, this is widely used by many data scientists, AI specialists, and HPC scientists worldwide. He also discussed about the challenges in designing runtime environments for MPI plus X programming models by taking into account support for multi-core systems, both IBM Power Systems as well as x86 systems, and high performance networks, GPUs, including GPU direct and RDMA support and all. And also he talked about the data processing unit, the emerging BlueField 2, which is actually going to be very useful for many enterprise cluster. When I say enterprise, it is for, you know, commercial applications, the commercial people like banking and, you know, the manufacturing or any other, you know, the enterprise related workload we are talking about here. And then the sample performance numbers and best practices of using MEA pitch 2 libraries also he shared. Hope you guys got some good glance about it. He's one of the best professors in the world who can talk about, you know, the high performance computing AI middleware. With all this info, you know, we all, like the Sastra and IBM and Open Power team, hope, you know, the students can go and develop applications using, you know, innovative libraries in our, you know, in the Sastra cluster, whatever we have been, you know, putting forward. And as part of a second talk, Mrs. Kamani and Vaibhav covered the machine learning fundamentals and how to deploy the application in Sastra cluster too. You know, we all know that, like, you know, the Jupyter notebook and all the stuff, you know, showcase. Do let us know if you have any questions. Reach us out. Always, we are available to help you out. And in the afternoon session, we brought in Florin Manila from Europe, who is actually the current AI leader for Europe. You know, he covers nearly 5-6 countries, top countries in Europe, and also he is an advisor for US some of the AI related, you know, opportunities and all. He covered several use cases, real time use cases where IBM helping the customers for deep learning, which can be certainly, you know, deployed in Sastra cluster 2. That's another thing here. All the use cases, whatever he talked about, the banking, manufacturing, healthcare, aerospace, all these use cases, certainly, you know, all these, you know, things, you know, we can deploy in Sastra cluster with the components we have here, V100 GPUs as well as A100 GPUs and K80 GPUs, at different GPUs and, you know, the different CPUs all available for, and the storage, and with the GPFS file system. you know, every student, you know, can do some, you know, wonders in that cluster. And also, Vaibhav later deployed the retinopathy diabetic solution using this, you know, Sastra cluster again, that is also available. And one can go ahead and start deploying similar stuff or improve the performance of the existing solutions too. As part of the last session, we just concluded, Abhinav discussed about Augmax tool. You know, let me tell you something, you know, this is actually a kind of one of the research tool, because for deep learning exercises, the data is very important. And that's where, you know, this Augmax plays a very important role there. This is one of the key research topics in deep learning in today's world. Abhinav also demonstrated how this tool can be used at Sastra cluster. You guys can go and try it out and read the paper. Definitely, we will share you all the materials, whatever we presented, and also the papers and all the stuff with all these features and live demonstrations. You know, certainly, you know, you can make a lot of, you know, world renowned publications and, you know, apply for, you know, higher studies and definitely, you know, demonstrate many solutions, you know, using the cluster here. And as part of tomorrow's, you know, the last day, the third day of the workshop, we are going to have sessions from Berner, one of the you know, enterprise customers for IBM USA. You know, the person is going to talk about enterprise AI, how AI is being used in enterprise, and what are the tools, you know, one can use, you know, for the enterprise AI. That kind of environment also we are planning to set it up in Sastra cluster. Enterprise AI, and also the second talk will be covered by one of my friend, you know, and also a professor, University of Wisconsin, Dr. Agya Das, about machine learning and how you know, he implemented, you know, working with the Facebook employee, developing a machine learning exercises. And also, like, the third talk is going to be given by IIT Jodhpur expert, MPI programming and benchmark using Sastra cluster. Once again, this is a connecting dots here. The Dr. Panda's MPI pitch has been installed already. And, you know, Mr. Devesh Sharma from IIT Jodhpur will be exploring that, you know, how to compile and how to run those benchmarks and how to add new features to the code and all the stuff. And once again, Abhishek Sharma will be sharing a silicon on a chip. This is a special session as part of this whole, you know, the Open Power workshop. Since the Open Power is available from silicon to the application, we are going to also demonstrate something which we developed and delivered to 400 students across India, including IITs and NITs. And, you know, it's basically going to be talking about how to design a chip, how to develop a chip, and, you know, and probably, like, you know, we'll have in another 6 months in our own chip, you know, running Linux and all other features. And the final session for tomorrow, Watson AI Ops. AI Ops is an important area right now. There are a lot of industries right now looking at it and going after how to use that for, you know, industries and, you know, many other, you know, customers and all. And, you know, certainly from my, you know, team, you know, the IBM colleagues will be presenting. There are three people going to be sharing the latest features, whatever we have in Watson AI Ops and other features too. Stay tuned for tomorrow to extend your skills in overall enterprise AI, AI solution, SoC design, and Watson application. With this, I'm closing, you know, I'm concluding my session here. And thanks a lot for being patient and being here from 9 a.m. to 4:07 p.m. Thank you all for all the participants, faculties, and organizers and presenters who have done an excellent work today. Thank you. See you all for tomorrow's session.
Thanks, Ganesh. Thank you very much. You may just sign off and we'll rejoin tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you all.